Muy buenos días, saludamos a todos los presentes el día de hoy en una edición más del Viernes Geocientífico, asimismo a nuestros seguidores a través de las redes sociales. Esta edición del Viernes Geocientífico es de manera muy especial, ya que tenemos a un expositor internacional. Contamos con la presencia del Dr. Hyun Doi-shin de la Universidad de Inha de Corea del Sur, que nos presentará el tema El reto y futuro de los recursos de petróleo y gas, el rol de los recursos no convencionales. Para su presentación invito al Dr. Gerardo Herboso, especialista de la Dirección de Geología Regional del INGEMET.
Today we have Professor Shin. He is a very renowned professor in South Korea doing unconventional resources. I met him in Kigan in 2018, and through messages, through WhatsApp and by email, we arranged a meeting today in Lima, and we are pleased that he is here with us. So please welcome Professor Shin for his presentation.
Good morning. Thank you very much. And my name is Hyun Doi-shin. So I'm from South Korea, but my nationality now is a Canadian. But I'm surprised every name is a Canada. So it's my pleasure to be here and have a chance to present some of my work. So I belong to petroleum engineering, so not a geologist, but I trained in geochemistry for my master's degree at university. So something a little bit familiar with some geology. So that's why we have the connection with him. So today the topic is challenge and future of oil and gas, and also some rules from unconventional resources. So outlines the introduction of some oil and gas industry, and how much resources we have in oil and gas, and how about the unconventional resources, and try to finish up the future challenges of oil and gas industries. So as you know, the oil and gas industry very big. So from the upstream to downstream. So upstream means the company only have the exploration and production and development. So the company who only have the business in upstream, we call independent company. They doesn't have any refinery or midstream. So only for exploration, development, production work they do. We call it an independent company. But like Shell or ExxonMobil and BP is a big major company. They dealing with everything from upstream to downstream. So midstream means some of the production processing and storage and transportation. So usually for transportation means the pipelines. And downstream, there is a refinery. So from the crude oil, we need distillations of the crude oil to make gasoline and naphtha and some other heavy stuff. But this one we have lots of related industry. For example, when you do exploration and production, you give lots of contracts to oil and gas service company like Schlumberger and Baker Hughes or Halliburton. So they do whatever we request and they get the service and they get the money. But they don't have any responsibility to find oil and gas. Even they fail to find oil and gas, but they get the pay. It's a safe, but we don't give them any contract, they cannot survive. So there is a really relate to oil price. If oil price high, they get more contracts and they make lots of money. But like last year, oil price around 40 or 50, the operator doesn't give any contracts and they difficult for situation. And that's why service company lay off the people during the downturn. So there are lots of related industry from the upstream to downstream, the drilling company and wireline company, or well test company, or some engineering company to build production facilities, especially for platform and offshore. And pipeline, there are lots of pipeline company, and they make lots of money after they construct the pipeline. And also for refinery cases, they have some gas station. So oil and gas industry, one of the biggest industry in the world. They deal only one single item, oil and gas. And as you know, for upstream, that's one try to exploration and development production, all the. But this area has high risk and high uncertainty because you're dealing with underground, subsurface, nobody can see underground. Only one tool you can see underground is drilling. But drilling gives only enough information to vertical directions. They don't have any horizontal directions. Maybe only 1 meter around the well bore, that is enough. If we want more detailed information about underground, every 10 meters you have to drill, but drilling is very expensive. Nobody can do that. So we have the limitation from the beginning for subsurface. So exploration, we try to where is the source rock and where is the seal and traps, all requirements they have. And if we find the oil and gas, there's enough to develop. So you decide, okay, we have enough oil and gas. Now we have to go development stage. You make a planning, how many wells you need and how much you can produce. Where is the market? You need a pipeline. Everything you have to design in advance. Otherwise, at the end, you lose the money. So be careful to planning for development stage. And then development stage, you have to select what kind of recovery process you need. Primary production is enough. Or reservoir pressure drop, you have to inject water flooding or polymer flooding. So other options you have to think. Whole recycles and depletion plans, and based on this plan, you make some field scale economic evaluations. From this project, how much money you can make, because you get the approval from the board to make sure we don't lose any money. So that is a very important stage. And then production, try to optimization your production and enhance oil recovery, what kind of things you do. And later of the life is the same kind of cemeteries. You have to P&A, that means plugged and abandoned. This one require lots of money. So that means you have to save some money during the production stage. Otherwise, end of the life, no money. That means you cannot plug. And then they eventually some problems for environmental issues. So government-wide, all the time they have the tight plan or regulation to the company forced to save some money in the future. It's a funeral for our cases, right? If you don't have money, it's a problem at the end of the life. But for oil and gas business, it takes a long time from the exploration and production, at least 10 years. From the beginning to start production. That means you have to your exploration in advance before oil price coming high. So 10 years later, oil price going up, today is very low, in that case you have to start exploration work today. When oil price high, you start exploration, 10 years later oil price down, when you start production, oil price lower than use money. So that kind of things, mechanisms happen during the oil and gas exploration. And another thing, there is a high risk and uncertainty. Why high risk? You start 100 exploration projects, you can probably can make money from 10 projects. The success rate is very low because we drill the wells to define oil is there. But nobody know from the exploration stage, find the oil. We don't know underground there is oil. We have to drill to find the oil. But first things, as you know, why the exploration for seismic things, that you're looking for house, like a structure. If oil is there, they should be that kind of structures, they contain the oil. But sometimes they contain water, sometimes oil. It's a chance. It's only 10% in frontier areas. But some areas, your neighbor, they have the oil there, very high chance to get find oil in your field. But new area, nobody there, there's no wells, it's very low chance. Reserve is a keep increasing. And nowadays they have booking 1.7 trillion barrels of oil. And world, how much they produce? Close to 100 million barrels per day. They come up with around 36 billion barrels per year. If you find any field higher than 500 million barrels, we call it a giant field. But in the world, you have consumed more than 70 giant fields every year. So we consume large. In Korea, very small country, they have how many? 50 million people with only 10 square kilometers in South Korea. They consume 2.8 million barrels oil per day. Every year they have the 1 billion barrels of oil, but they produce only 200 barrels oil every day. And that field finish in 2 years. So that's why Korea, they very interesting overseas oil and gas business. They invest lots of money. And there are a couple of events in increasing the world reserve size. And 1989, nobody know, suddenly Middle East, they increase their reserve. But nobody know, they did any technical stuff. Maybe they change their mind and they increase the numbers. Nobody know. And another event is the end of 1999, the Canadian, they booking more than 200 billion, close 160 billion barrels of oil from oil sand. So this one is very viscous and very high density, that means oil quality actually is the best. And another thing in Venezuela, from the Chavez since 2005, they invest lots of money to evaluation their own field, and they book another 200 billion. So these two, Canadian oil sand and Venezuela extra heavy oil, they count more than 400 billion barrels of oil. That means around one fourth of total world reserve size from heavy oil. And that means that we looking for RP ratio, that means reserve size divided by production rate, then come up with how many years you can use. And worldwide now they use 50 years from the reserve these days we book. So don't worry, right? 50 years is a long time. And then something changed because they use some other resources. Not oil and gas. Even coal mine, they probably want more than 200 years they can use. So we have enough. But why this kind of things happen? When I joined to university, I heard 25 years later, we cannot use anymore for oil and gas. But you guys working hard and you find more oil, and now increase up to 50 years. Please keep going, so don't worry, we have enough. And oil price change by cycles. Usually we call it a mega cycle, basically 20 or 15 years. But logic is very simple. When oil price high, the company make lots of money and they reinvest the money to exploration. But I mentioned it takes 10 years, more than 10 years to produce from the beginning of exploration. So you make lots of money and invest, the success of your exploration, given the production after 10 years. That means oil price high for 10 years, you invest a lot of money, in 10 years later, your production increase. And then production increase means the oil price down. So oil price low, the company didn't have enough money to invest again. And less invest, that means production decline. And 10 years later, oil price going up. So that's why they basically have the cycles. So you have to utilize that one, but government don't worry about that one, right? They own it for companies. And there are a couple of times, but it's ideally, it's a good idea if you have enough money or a government company, they can invest when oil price low. And then they guarantee in the future, 10 years later, maybe oil price low high, you can produce more and you make lots of money. And then you save that money for in the, another future. So it's a kind of cycles. So that means you have to prepare in advance. But it's very difficult to make action because you don't have the money. Because there is a petroleum project all the time, take a long time, we call it a long lead time. And also oil price cycles is very long. Okay, why the petroleum have the problems? Because only few countries have most of the oil and gas reserve. If you look at this one, which country have the most reserve is Venezuela. They close to 300 billion barrels. Second one, Saudi Arabia, they have the 265 billion barrels. Third is a Canadian oil sand, close to 170 billion barrels. And some other Iran and Iraq and Kuwait, UAE in Middle East. So top 10 countries contain more than 70% of total world reserve. That means if the company come together, they decide, okay, we cut the production, that means oil price going up. They usually hope that they do. But now they did change because of the shale oil. I can explain this one later. And as I mentioned, oil reserve in the world 1.7 trillion barrels. And IP ratio means how many years we can use that reserve. So 50 years. And yesterday I checked how much the Peru have the reserve from the BP statistics based on only these years. And 1.2 billion barrels you have. And how much you produce? 127,000 barrels per day. And how much you consume? 260. That means you have to import 50%. Still, right? And how many years you can use? Probably next 26 years you can produce with this rate. So that means after 30 years, you may not have enough petroleum to produce, but this one totally depends on you guys. How you work hard, you can make more money and more reserve. One example for this guy, in we call it a Ghawar field in Saudi Arabia at the top. Looks like the human leg, the shape. It's one field, the width is around 30 kilometers, and the length around 300 kilometers. It's a huge reserve. How many have they have? 170 billion barrels of resources on the ground. How much they produce? Every day they produce 5 million barrels from one field. So huge, it's twice the amount of the Korea they produce every day, consume, but they produce 5 million barrels. It's a top one big field in the world. And bottom part is a gas field, it's a Qatar. The shape is the Qatar by the same shape of the, their country they have the gas field. Across that country there has a boundary with Persian Gulf with Iran. So they share, one third belong to Iran and two third belong to Qatar. So Qatar produce conventional gas and they make lots of LNG. And Korea import lots of LNG from Qatar. So that's why only several countries have oil and gas, that's why they start all the problems happen. Okay, what happened in the next? what is the world energy change? At this moment, oil, coal, and gas, they are the main resources and energy resources for world. How much? 82% from fossil fuels. These three resources. Only 18% some other nuclear plus renewable energies, include some biomass. What happened in the future? There are something changed, they dropped 70%. What is meaning? 82 down 75. That means the world used less fossil fuels? No. Only fractions decreased. But you know how many people live in China? 1.5 billion people. How about India? 1.3 billion. So total two countries, close to 3 billion people live there. They use individuals small amount of the oil and gas. So some other countries who start on the developing countries, they still need lots of energy. So they predict 2035, they demand this amount of energy, annual demand growth. The half of the growth we have to meet with fossil fuels. That is a reality. Even we really try to contribute lots of things from biomass and renewable energy, but still half of the demand for growth, we are still dealing with fuel, like fossil fuels. That is the, our future. Okay, how the energy they use? This one for typical in United States, but I look in the Korea almost same. Okay, from the source of the energy, petroleum, number one source, 36%. Natural gas, 25%. And coal, still 20%. And renewable energy, less than 10%. And nuclear, 8%. But we have to look at which sector we have to use different resources. For example, where you use the petroleum. You distill the petroleum and make the gasoline and use it for your car. So 70% using for transportation. And 23% you use petrochemical industry like the naphtha. And you make lots of clothes or plastic, everything. In our life, 87% from petroleum product. So you cannot live any single day. Same as the made in China, you cannot live in the world, except for United States. They cannot live with a made in China product. It's the same thing happened. And natural gas, one-third used for petrochemical, for industry, and one-third for residential and commercial, and one-third electric power generation. And coal, they main use for electric power. And renewable energy, they use from industry and electric power, and nuclear 100% electric power. But how much electric power they use from the sector? Less than 50%. So somebody think in the future we have the electric car. But you have to think where the electricity generates. These days, mainly from fossil fuels and nuclear power plant. So nothing changed. This looks very clean in front of your eyes. But some of your backyard, somebody burning lots of hydrocarbon, including coal. So that's why the issues is not simple. You have to think of the economics for money to generate electric power. And also, you have to think of environmental issues because you fire burning lots of coal, there's a fine dust to change your climate. And nuclear waste disposals, long-term impact, only not 100 years, 1,000 years, they probably impact several or 10,000 years later in our future generations. If energy density concentrate the chance of the accident is low, but the impact, one accident happen, the impact is huge. So that's why if you're burning your wood at home, maybe you just burn your house itself, right? But what happens, electric power plant, like the nuclear power plant, have some problems, whole town or whole country get damaged. So that's why they have some different level of security. So in Korea these days, they try to change energy paradigms, avoid from nuclear power plant and coal. But we don't have much options because only 5% energy from renewable energy. But how can handle 95% of energy? It's very difficult. Okay, future petroleum. Just look at the bottom of the left side, that means statistics I make, that means each country, one person for 1 year, how much oil they use. For example, United States people, they more than 20 barrels per every year per person. Korea, very close to United States. And Japan and UK, around 10 barrels per person per year. But looking at China and India, China, they use only 3 barrels per person. India, 1 barrel. Okay, in the future, China and India, 33 billion people use the oil and gas, just half of Korea or half of America. We have to produce 70% more oil. That is a big challenge. Even they change from some source of energy, some other things, but still, I believe some damage or something we have to do before. So we need more reserve, and also there are some problems in the conventional oil. We call easy oil. Everybody easily exploration and produce. So remaining things is a more difficult one. That include unconventional resources, or deep sea. The water thickness deeper than 1.5 kilometers, or 2 kilometers. In some areas, nobody touched yet, in the Arctic areas. But somebody like the global warming, it's easy to access to Arctic area, more activities. But how you can increase the reserve size? How many percentage you can recover from the your existing field? Recovery factor less than 35% average. That means still 65% or 70% oil remaining underground from the your well. So that's why we try to develop some new technology for enhanced oil recovery. Try to increase your recovery factor. That means you already found the oil, you can improve the reserve. Same field. The other things, you have to find new field. But as I mentioned, it's difficult to find a new field because all the easy oil you already found. The remaining is unconventional resources and deep sea and Arctic. So that's why there's the three. In the future petroleum resources, we have what is the characteristic or future features of the unconventional resources? If you compare conventional things, you have couple of wells, one field. Because the oil and gas is a liquid, it's a different from the mining side. How you can recover the mining? You have to contact. Directly contact and digging out. But for fluid like oil and gas, you don't need to digging out. You just insert the piping after drilling and then drop the pressure and then all the fluid coming through. Same as the water well. So that's why we need very long distance well bores, well distance. But if the drop the energy, you need some interest. But still, the distance in the individual wells is very long. But conventional things, we have problems. I mentioned it later, but we have two problems. One is permeability itself is very low. That means even the gas cannot easily flow. The other stuff, oil itself is very viscous. So they cannot move. That means we have to do something before production. Otherwise, we cannot produce. That's why we need very dense well spacing. For example, for shale gas, well spacing, 200 meters distance, they drilled 1.6 kilometers wells on the ground. And oil sand is worse. Every 100 meters, sometimes 50 meters. You need two well pairs, 800 meters length. That means on the ground, as you mentioned, all the things, the maps looks like the line. That means the well trajectory. So that means unconventional resources, they have the large scale, they need lots of drilling work, and they have the huge facilities to treat. Because to produce, you inject steam, or hydrofracturing, you inject high pressure with chemicals and sand. So you have to separate flow back water. So that means you have to guarantee larger facilities. That's why this unconventional resource is very difficult to implementation in offshore. Because offshore platform, very small, restricted area to operate. And they need lots of infrastructure like the pipeline and service company. That's why North America is a better position. Why North America produces unconventional resources? The reason is very simple. They don't have enough conventional resources. They don't have options except to produce oil from unconventional resources. But they pay attention in these areas maybe 30 years ago. So they did some work before coming to the surface. So that's why they utilize the existing pipeline system, also service company. There are lots of service companies. They pick the phone and they call, we want to drill tomorrow. They can bring the rig. So it's very easy. They have lots of service company there. So that's why they all the infrastructures and all the skilled workers there. That's why North America is a better position. And oil and gas industry has a big impact to other industries. That's why the country who has lots of resources, their industry actually get booming. Not only produce gas, make money from the oil and gas, but the related industry is huge. When you drill, they utilize a lot of materials, or pipe, or workers. That means it make lots of people get a job. So that's why United States, after shale gas booming, they guarantee lots of jobs to the United States people. So that's why they like to try to develop shale gas. And what they have the mechanism for this one, petroleum industry, at a large scale and they long-term project and dependent on technology and they hold from the bottom to top integrated business. And also they have a lot of related industries like for production stage, for drilling exploration and facility design, they relate for engineering based on exploration production company and oil and gas service companies. And design facilities, we call engineering design. And you need EPC company. That means construction company, the facilities. So there are lots of companies or industry related. How about the transportation for midstream? They need some storage tank and pipelines. They need lots of pipeline or steel pipe. And refineries. Refinery and production shares, you need the gas stations, and also you use this one for electric power plant. So everything related. So that's why the company or countries who have a lot of reserve in oil and gas, they have more potential to develop to other industry, include the whole national economy. Okay, For unconventional resources, there are two issues, low permeability or high viscosity. So low permeability means the matrix, the rock, instead low permeability. That means fluid cannot move too far. That's why you need to drill more wells with tight formations, or you have to fracture it. So this one, only one equation I can remember. We call it a Dice equation. That is mu over k delta p, the production rate. You can see some Korean languages. In permeability, we call it tugado. You can see. And if you increase the production, how you can change? You can increase permeability or reduce viscosity and increase delta p. But you cannot control much delta p from surface pressure and downward pressure difference. Okay, if we want increase K, that means shreyas and tight gas formation, you have to hydrofracturing job and increase permeability. And how you can reduce viscosity, like a heavy oil, oil sand, you inject steam. That means energy. You inject heat and reduce viscosity and you can flow it back. It's very simple way, but these two jobs, actually, you inject some materials into downhole. That means you have probably some issues in environmental things. You may have a chance to contaminate your environment because you inject some materials from the outside. And later, you fluid back and you have to separate. That's why you have the huge facilities to treat unconventional resources development. Also, the production cost should be high because you have to inject some materials or hydrofracturing jobs. So that's why unconventional resources development required certain level of high oil price. Couple of years ago, before 2014, before oil price down $40, at that time, shale gas make money when oil price is $70. Nowadays, they still can make money with $30 oil price. Why this kind of things happen? They try to develop new technology or reduce the money for operations. But lots of companies interested in when oil price high, they just focus on more production. But oil price low, production itself is not much interesting, they more interested in the reduced operating cost. So that's why new technology try to reduce the operating cost all the time happen when downturn, oil price is lower. So that's why we need sometimes low oil price to enhance or improve our technology. Okay, shale gas production technology, we use two technology. One is a horizontal well drilling and the other one hydrofracturing. So horizontal drilling, actually they improve contact areas with reservoir. So that means individual segment of a pipe produce small amount of oil and gas. But if the length of the wells extend to 1 kilowatt, 2 kilometers, you add more oil and gas production. So improve contact areas with type A, with horizontal wells, because usually your reservoir is a flat. Thickness maybe maybe 10 or 50 meters thickness, but extensions maybe several kilometers. So that's why you can chance to improve the contact areas. And the other one, multi-frac stage, that means you drill 1.5 kilometers well length, and you make a segment. And each segment we call stage. The length of stage around 150 meters range. And you make frac, individual stage. What happened? You just drill long well, and perforation one side and fracture. That means you have only one single fracture. This is not effective. So that's why you make some segment with the packers. And more multi-stage, that you can produce more oil, but you need some optimizations because each stage of fracturing, you need money. So that's why how many stages you want to drill and fracturing, you have to design based on cost. And in the future for gel production, mainly still conventional gas is the mainstream. But some of the North America, they handling conventional gas, unconventional gas. So from the beginning, United States at this moment, more than 40% of gas production from shale gas. Some of the Canada, maybe 5-10%, and China, 2% of total production from shale gas, and Mexico, they didn't start. These four countries, in the future, main unconventional gas production countries. How much they up to 40, 2040? United States, more than 70% of total gas production from shale gas. And Canada, China, around 40% range. And Mexico, they don't have much conventional gas. So they probably focus on unconventional gas. Still, mainly for 60% of the 2040, still from conventional gas in the world, but close to 30% from unconventional gas, especially for shale gas. Okay, gas price. How the gas price change? Before 2005, not much different. From the $6 to $9, and then not much change between LNG and PNG. Okay, United States, gas price per MMBTU, million British thermal unit, that close to thousands standard cubic feet. How much? That $3. This day is still $3. And Germany, 2007, $6, and UK, $6. And LNG in Japan and Korea, close to $8. Why the gas price change? Because they depend on the type of transportation. So if you deliver it through pipeline in semi-continental, that means you just need a pipeline. And you just pay the pipeline tariff, $2, and you can easily transfer. So Germany and UK, most of European countries, where they get the gas delivery from? Russia. So sometimes Russia, the mood or, oh, I don't like, and they close the bell. And EU countries, no supply. But they have options. They get gas from America now. United States, America, they make a gas and they deliver gas to cross the Atlantic Ocean. But gas actually 600 times bigger volume than liquid. So that means you have to build 600 times bigger vessels compared to oil. So it's impossible. So that's why you make liquid from the gas. So liquefaction. But natural gas, the composition mainly methane gas. So methane gas is an interesting gas. Usually some gas, you just pressurize, they taste change to liquid. But this guy never changed to liquid, only pressurized. That's why you have to make frozen. Minus 162 degrees C, you make frozen. This guy with atmosphere pressure. And then you reduce 600 times your volumes, and you can ship in some special things. But for LNG carriers or LNG ships, you need almost perfect insulation because outside the temperature is high, and you frozen 162. If they increase the temperature, lots of liquid LNG turn into vaporized to gas again. So that's why LNG shipping is very difficult challenge and very expensive. And the other thing is for LNG price, in correlate or relate to petroleum oil gas, oil price, usually 1/7. because why they calculate that one based on energy balance. So if you boil your water for coffee, you have to decide, I can use burning for oil or I can burn gas. And then you can compare this one, okay, 1.7 is equal. So that's why if the energy price A means oil price should be less than $60 or around $50. So that's why these things will depend on the oil price, energy price fixed. But the other things is a separate gas price. But usually for energy cost should be expensive for liquefaction and shipping with LNG ship, and at the terminal when you get import LNG and you have to make gas again. So we call regasification. So that kind of process you need some money. So basically two cheap cases, that means you have the bigger facilities, you can save some money. But small case, you have to pay more money. So around $4 to extra. So that means without any relationship with oil, if the United States gas price $3, that means LNG gas price minimum $7, if we consider the cost. The gas scenarios they did 2010, so I put this one because they estimations for gas price in the future. So they expect 2015 in United States gas price close to $6, but still $3. The message from this one, nobody know oil and gas price. Don't trust any institute announce the oil and gas price. It's all the time wrong. That is a normal thing. Even United States IEA, EIA, they predict. But 1 year later, change again, they update. Maybe daily update. So everything changes. But still, we have long-term cycles. 20 years or 15 years cycles that probably they, you can apply that one. Oh. And we need some balance for how much you produce and how much you can treat or how much you can deliver to market. So we call it a balance in upstream to downstream. If you look at the old workflow from the production, transportation, market, that means production capacity, pipeline capacity, and your market capacity. There are some bottlenecks. If you produce more, but you don't have any pipeline, you have to stay as your oil and gas very cheap, because you cannot deliver. So that kind of things you have to own business aspect, where the bottlenecks happen. So that's why you in advance increase pipeline capacity or refinery capacity. So all the things related. Instead for gas, you produce the gas in domestic, you can use the pipeline. But if you want the market to overseas, you have to arrange facilities. So that's why United States now, they try to, or Canada, try to build more energy facilities. Because they produce lots of gas, but in domestic, they have enough gas to use, they have to export. Otherwise, you have to discount it, gas price like United States, only $3 for next 7 years. So still, we have problems. So it's a problem for somebody, that means it's a chance for somebody. All the time. And some Arctic areas, there are some problems in seismography, but that means one big problem, they have only 2 or 3 months work period, because the weather is too cold, so you cannot work. So if you drill, it's a drilling maybe take 6 months, that means you have to wait another year. After 3 months drilling, wait until next year when the warm period and you drill again. This is very difficult. That means exploration terms should be longer than any conventional cases. That's why they're looking for more than 20 years exploration stages. But maybe you can wait until several years, maybe the global warming. So maybe longer working period you can have there. But terminal technology, they very difficult because the ice and storms, and so you cannot shock any 3D. is very difficult with the ice. And difficult to drilling, very short work conditions and very expensive, sometimes more than $500 million for drill one well. It's very expensive. And also they have some extended reach drilling, that means they drill from the land to the long distance, several kilometers. And if something happens, the emergence or leaking or spills happen, it's very difficult to tapping or any happen like the Gulf of Mexico for the water horizon. It's a relief wells, it's very difficult in this one. It takes several years maybe, depending on the accident. And also, finally, we have some issues in environmental things. Because everything reactions very slow in cold region, that means it takes a long time to offset the issues in Arctic areas. And this one, I just looking at United States more details or different eyes, because they have enough shade and shadow. But if we look at the real data, these are from the BP statistical every year. And since 2010, they tried booking more reserve because of the shale oil. So shale oil around increased to 20 billion barrels. United States, they produce almost 11 million barrels per day. And they consume close to 20 million barrels. That means they still import around 8 million barrels per day. So number one country to consume. In China, second one, they consume 10 million barrels per day. We think that it's keep increasing. Probably a couple of years later, maybe they overpass the United States. It's very difficult to expectations. So if you're looking at how much they produce, they have the now close to 50 billion barrels reserve in the United States. If you convert this one to 11 billion barrel per day production rate, IP ratio means 10 years. So that means 50 billion barrels of oil in the United States, they can produce in 10 years. So in the beginning, I mentioned it takes more than 10 years from exploration to production. So that's why they start open Arctic areas for exploration and some Atlantic areas. Because they keep exploration, because if they success in exploration to find oil, the production line up after 10 years. So they actually preparing everything. Even they produce lots of oil from the shale oil, but they still looking for behind the shale oil. And in petroleum areas, you need integration or collaboration. From the beginning for upstream to downstream, even inside upstream, exploration to production, sometimes geology to production or subsurface and surface, everything should be integrated to optimization. And collaborations. The collaborations for different industry or different country, or different areas. There is no freedom. If you're looking at hydrofracturing technology for shale gas, it's more than take 100 years ago. Okay, for left side horizontal wells, first horizontal well drilling, 1929 in Texas. And commercialized only 1980s. And hydrofracturing, first hydrofracturing jobs, 1947, and commercialized one, 1997. So shale gas starts get combination of these two technologies. So that's why the integration, the technology is a very key stuff to improve our efficiency and guarantee more reserve in the future. So that's why it takes a long time and continuous effort to develop the technology. So that's why nobody knows what we're doing, but eventually left 10 or 20 years, somebody did before. Otherwise, we stay same level. So that's why the R&D is very important portion in oil and gas. Even nobody recognize you, but we have to keep doing. I think that is my presentation. Thank you very much.